His name is Bryan Trottier. He won Stanley Cups in bunches. Joe Tilley's Great Canadian Sports Show, coming up! Yes, we are very excited about today's guest. He hails from Valmarie, Saskatchewan. He played junior for the Swift Current Broncos. He had 524 goals, 901 assists, and 1,279 NHL games over 18 seasons with the Islanders and the Penguins. He was one of eight NHL players to have multiple five-goal games. He shares the NHL record for most points in a period with six. He won the Calder Trophy, the Art Ross Trophy, the Hart Trophy, the Conn, Smythe Trophy, won six Stanley Cup titles as a player, another Stanley Cup as an assistant coach. He is a member of the Hockey Hall of Fame. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the program, Bryan Trottier. Bryan, good to see you, my friend. You look good.
Hey, what a welcome. Thanks, Joe. That was great.
Beautiful. Yeah, we had lots to work with this week, Bryan, trust me. I want to start at the beginning. We always do. I Googled Valmarie, Saskatchewan, a village of 120 people, the gateway to Grasslands National Park. They've got a museum and a theater. Did I miss anything?
Well, the skating rink is named after me, so I'm really the community hall. And no, it was a vibrant little town when I was growing up, maybe 300-400 people. But, like all small towns, Saskatchewan, the kids move away. The dads stay. Some of the kids move back to take over the farm and ranch. But no, our little ranch is part of Grasslands National Park now, which is a little bit sad, but the homestead is still standing, so to speak, the old corrals. But it was a great place to grow up. Lots of just wonderful, wonderful memories. And the people around there, just really good, hardworking people, proud people. And I sneak back there, we all share stories. We all come from somewhere. I'll tell you, that little Valmarie is a metropolis in my mind.
You're right. We all come from somewhere. Of course, they had a rink there. They had to have a rink there to produce a Bryan Trottier. But how do you get from Valmarie, Saskatchewan to the NHL? How does that happen?
A little luck, good fortune, a dream that, you just kind of see, how far it's going to take you. An opportunity knocks and, we had mums from a town 40 miles away, a little town called Climax, Saskatchewan. Gordy Kluzak got some NHL time. And it's really kind of those little towns that kind of band together. We went to a lot of tournaments and you can kind of get seen by people. And through Pee-wee, Bantam, Midget, Stan Dunn, the coach of the Broncos, saw a lot of our hockey. And a lot of us kids got to go to camp and try out. You meet a guy named Tiger Williams in Swift Current, and he takes you under your wing, and he kind of becomes my big brother. And actually, you're playing against big guys like, Clark Gillies, Lanny McDonald, Tom Lysiak, and the WHL. He's like, oh my God, I think I can do this, I'm going to see how far this takes me. And then opportunity knocks again, and scouts see you, and you have an opportunity to see if you can make it the NHL. It's just another door opens, and you jump in, you just give it your best shot. And, it's not an easy road, but if you maintain and you kind of stick with it and you take advantage of opportunities and, I had good coaching, I had good teammates and, I look back and say, geez, what a path. So what do? I at age 65, I said, I'm going to write a book. And so I wrote a book called All Roads Home. That's coming out here in October. So we get to promote that a little bit. Thanks, Joe.
Awesome. Yes, then, of course.
It's really kind of fun. It's going to be like my path to the NHL, some fun stories growing up and some family stuff and then some teammate stuff and, nothing dramatic, nothing black. It's a pretty fun book. I'm sure kind of like, I knew there was a story in me. I just, taking the time where I'm not, I had the time, through COVID to do something. And it came out great. My daughter was involved. She's a journalist and she got involved. And we got, Penguin Random House folks were fantastic to work with. So, I hope people enjoy it. It'll be a lot of fun.
Well, I don't want to steal too much from the book, but I, you know, doing my research, I uncovered an interesting story about you and Tiger Williams, the kid from the former Leaf, the kid from Weyburn. Actually, it's a funny story, but a very short story. I'll make it very short. I actually coached his brother, Sid, in boxing way back in the day. When I was in working at Red Deer, I just finished my amateur career, and I was coaching Sid, and we won an Alberta title together. So that was kind of fun. Anyway, congrats. I digress.
Yeah, Sid was a good boxer.
Yeah. He was, yeah. So was Morgan, Dave's older brother, Morgan. He was a good fighter.
Yeah, Morgan was really good boxer. Yeah, the whole family was into boxing.
Yeah,
obviously, yeah. Tiger wasn't afraid of boxing, but he like.
Yes.
So what's really fun to me was getting to know the whole Williams family. I mean, it's a pretty dynamic group of folks, and just a wonderful family. You know, like a lot of family values, and just you know, through the years, you know, maintaining that friendship's been spectacular.
Right. Yeah, we went for a trip to Weyburn one time. We were fighting a Saskatchewan team there, and met Dave's dad, and he really nice gentleman. And you know, it's a family affair. They had a lot of success. They're hardworking people and good folks. But I want to say I know that Tiger Williams played a big role in you staying with the Swift Current Broncos. Tell us about that story.
Yeah, Tiger's dad Taffy is just like that. Tiger looks exactly like his dad now. It's impressive how we morph into our parents, how we start looking like and acting like him, that kind of stuff. But Tiger was Tiger's one of those guys. I don't know. He maybe saw something. I was just getting ragdolled. Hockey wasn't much fun for a while, and you know, when you're, you know, 15, 16 years old, you're getting, you know, pounded on by 18, 19, 20 year olds. It wasn't fun. I'd go on the ice and some guy would like say, hey, you know, it'll, for no reason. I said, what's going on here? But it was just, I guess it's just what they do in junior hockey. They test your fortitude or whatever. And I was going home for Christmas and I wasn't coming back. And, you know, Boxing Day, Tiger shows up and drags me back to Swift Current, plays left wing with me, and hockey was fun again. So that's the quick story, because there's nobody looked at me. Every time somebody looked at me, Tiger beat the hell out of him. It was kind of comical. Like, what'd that guy do? I don't know. I owed him. Like, okay.
What?
It just... It was just kind of fun having on the left side. And that's why I call him a big brother, because he just, you know, he taught me how to grapple, taught me how to take care of myself, and just all those things that are necessary, I think, to survive at that time. But it was just a special, special guy, special friendship. And, you know, there's those moments, defining moments in your life, you know, players that you played with, Will Disjardins, you know, Tiger Williams, Mike Bossy, Clark Gillies, Dennis Pott, all those guys that are so become very special to you, that, you know, you want to make sure that, you know, you not just appreciate the friendship, but it's just a tribute to just a, you know, two personalities that blend and, you know, form and forge, I think is the best way to say it. Just a real tight, tight bond. And it's great. I love the guy.
Well, you weren't a big guy, but having Tiger Woods on your wing, kind of adds a couple inches and a few pounds to any player, right? Like when Gretzky was playing with Semenko, he was a little tougher too. I mean, we all grow when we had those opportunities, right? All the players. Well,
not that I felt tougher. It's just that I wasn't afraid. And when someone teaches you how to grapple, and Tiger was fearless. Tiger just was. I used to like, oh my God, he's not the biggest guy either. But you know, he went against everybody, and he was. By far and away, our fearless leader. And, you know, he just made us all feel a little, like you said, bigger. I didn't feel much tougher, but I didn't feel like I had to be afraid. And I wasn't scared. I wasn't nervous. I wasn't looking over my shoulder all the time, who's going to come and pound on me? Because if anybody even looked at me sometimes, a guy would just come up and just challenge me. Tiger would jump and just beat the hell out of him. What was that all about? I don't know. We're sending a message. I'm like, okay, whatever. It was good, because like all off ice, you know, the friendship, he come down to the ranch, help our branding and pick bales, and you know, mom and dad just kind of, we all fell in love with him. And it's just a big part of our family and a big part of my history for sure.
So you get drafted by the Islanders in round two, after a successful couple of years at Swift Current, because when you went back, things worked pretty good. 32 goals, 63 assists for 95 points in your first season. You win the Colorado Trophy. What a way to start your career. How did that feel to, to win the Calder? Did you expect that kind of an introduction to the NHL?
Expect no, but I think what you do is, like, going into camp was interesting because I didn't know what to expect at that level. I'd gone down, skated with the players, believe it or not, during their playoff run the year before, or that spring, and then go back to the fall. And I think it was familiar. The guys were familiar, but you don't take anything for granted. And, you know, Ed Westfall, JP Parisi, some of the veterans were just fantastic. You know, they kind of, like, you know, again, just settle you down, you know, just play hockey, you get on the ice and you just do your thing. But training camp was tough. I didn't get it. I wasn't expected to stay because I was still small. But, you know, Al didn't put me with anybody per se during exhibition series where I could put up some offensive numbers, or didn't get any power play time, didn't kill any penalties. And so I didn't have any goals that I can think of. Maybe had a couple of assists, and they weren't, like, you know, great assists. But when the season started, he put me with Clark Gillies and Billy Harris. And boom, you know, 2-2 tie in Kansas City wasn't too, but the next game at Nassau Coliseum, I have a 5-point game, and then boom, next thing you know, I'm in, you know, 10 games into the season, they had to make a decision whether I was going to stay or go, and I'm tied at the top with Guy Lafleur for the scoring chase. And, okay, we're gonna keep you around, you know, till Christmas, and, you know, I bunked in with the family, and, you know, nothing was ever settled down. I was just playing my heart out and doing the best I can. And, you know, our team was doing well. Our line was doing well. And, you know, the power play was zinging along. And, you know, there's just a lot of good things happened that first year. And, you know, I just rode that wave and made sure that I was minding my P's and Q's and, you know, staying very dedicated and diligent, you know, last guy off the ice sort of thing. And, you know, and I think what happened was, I think, you know, opportunity just kind of, like, unveiled itself through that first year. And you know, I think a lot of good things happened, but at the same time, I was on a mission. Like, I didn't want to go back to junior. I didn't want to go to the minors. I wanted to stay in the NHL, and I enjoyed it, and the guys were really good to me, the team, Al and everybody. And you can't take anything for granted. I didn't. And from there, it just kind of went on. And next thing you know, you're getting a trophy for this, a trophy for that. It reflects well on everybody. It reflects well on our team.
Well, you know, you talk to anybody who's made it in any sport, and there's a common theme. The common thread is, you know, you work bloody hard. It's something you want to do. And if you want to reach the top, you've got to work as hard or harder than anybody else. And that's how you get there. But I want to talk about the draft, because we had Jimmy Devil on the show a couple of months back, and he talked about drafting Bryan Trottier and others. It helped the fact that you guys were not a great team, but he had some gems here. Let's hear that, Vic.
We had a bird dog out west in Swift Current, and he kept talking to me all year about this young 18-year-old kid, young Indian kid, playing for Swift Current with 2 years of junior to go, but what his potential was, what his upside was, and his name was Bryan Trottier. So we took a chance. We took Bryan Trottier in the second round. And, you know, Joe, if you think about getting a Potvin, and then the next year you get a Clark Gillies and you get a Bryan Trottier, and our bird dog in Swift Current was bang on about Trottier. A little bit of a gamble at that point in time. But, boy, oh, boy, here we are 3 years into the league, and we've gone from last place to becoming a pretty good playoff team, not a Stanley Cup team, but a pretty good team. So that was a heck of a haul for us.
What do you think of Jimmy's comments?
Oh, I think Jimmy likes to like swell things up a little bit, exaggerate. But, you know, like, you got to love those bird dogs. And you know, the thing that happened with the NHL was the World Hockey Association was stealing 17, 18-year-olds, and they weren't drafting them until they were 20. And I fell in that little small group of 17, 18-year-olds that just kind of fell in that calendar year where they had to draft you in the top two rounds or miss you. And the WHA was going to – so it was a gamble, but they were also kind of forced to take guys like Pierre LaRouche, myself, and others that were younger – but, you know, had some skill, but just weren't that big yet. And I was so jealous of Pierre LaRouche for staying, but you know, I was small. I was really small. Like I wasn't big. I was 100 and maybe 70, 175 pounds that year. And you know, playing with Swift Current at that draft year, you know, and I went back to junior. I grew 2 inches and put on another 15 pounds. So, you know, I got bigger. You know, you mature, and I think to the Islanders' credit, you know, take a little gamble on a small kid. You know, from remote Saskatchewan, you know, they didn't have a lot on me. But I had good mentoring like that through Tiger. I got passed on to Earl Ingerfield, and Earl Ingerfield in Lethbridge was fantastic. You talk about getting a giant step, a head start against, a lot of young kids. Like I had Earl Ingerfield as a coach and mentor like that last year in junior. And, you know, he was eyeballs to the Islanders, and, you know, I couldn't take a minute off. And I didn't want any bad news going back to the Islanders. So I never felt pressure. I thought this was the greatest opportunity that a young kid could have. And I'd pick Earl's brains, and I'd get like 30 minutes a game. I was in every situation, wore the C that year. I mean, there was just a lot of good things that, you know, like that happened to me along the way that, you know, don't happen to a lot of other kids. But I love Jimmy's story. There's so many different stories. Like Al Arbor tells the story of draft day, and you know, Earl Ingerfield tells the story. Odd Erickson called me and told me the story, and there was a lot of debate. You know, they're taking a chance, they're taking a big risk on a young kid, and there were players that were 19 that were just probably, you know, had better stats, were bigger guys, and you know, they were only in the second round of the, you know, they had Clark Gillies, a big left winger, and you know, they could have grabbed Tiger Williams, I heard. They could have grabbed Dougie Risebrough. They could have grabbed a whole bunch of other guys. And you know, I kind of lucked out and thank them, you know, for picking me, because I got to play with Clark Gillies and Dennis Potvin and Mike Bossy and Billy Smith and, you know, Hall of Famers, and we formed this core group that, you know, goes on to win a whole bunch of championships in a row. That it's going to be a tough one to beat. You know, there's some special records that Islander team achieved that are going to be tough to beat. You know, like an American team winning 4 straight Stanley Cups. I mean, that's going to be tough to do, and especially in free agency world right now. But you know, just the NHL is a special place to play hockey, and the players that are playing there now are just fantastic athletes, and you know, they're putting on a great, entertaining brand of hockey. You know, my era, we're very proud of it. We love our guys, we love the game, we loved everything about it. We learned how to win from Montreal, and you hear Edmonton saying they wanted to win Stanley Cups like the Islanders, so they did the same thing, you know, we did to Montreal. They just studied us and just kind of watched how we practiced and conducted ourselves and behaved. And that's what we did to Montreal. We just wanted to be like Larry Robinson and Guy Lafleur and, you know, Jean Béliveau before them. And it was just really kind of, you know, you learn from champions. And, you know, Al Arbor was wonderful telling me stories about, you know, Stan Mikita or Dave Keon, you know, guys that, I don't know, he did it on purpose, I think, just to kind of rev me up. But it was really wonderful to hear those stories because, you know, they're champions. They're great players, Hall of Fame guys. And you want to play in the NHL. You want to be the best of the best. And my whole reason for going to the NHL, well, yeah, I want to play in the NHL, play one game, one shift, whatever. But I wanted to win a Stanley Cup. Like, I just didn't want to play in the – I wanted to win a Stanley Cup. I wanted to raise Lord Stanley's Cup over my head, just like Gordie Howe and Jean Béliveau. And I can remember, you know, and I tell the story in the book. It's like I was 8 years old. I turned to my dad. I was watching Hockey Night in Canada, and Jean Béliveau got to hug the cup. He put it up, and I said to myself, Dad, I want to win a Stanley Cup like Jean Béliveau. He looked at me and says, well, you better start practicing. And, you know, I skated on that little creek by the house, you know, cold, cold weather, some blizzards and dead cows frozen in the river. And, you know, you just skate around them, no big deal. Twigs and you maybe that's how I skated, a little choppy, but I don't know. I just think, you like you said, it takes a lot of will, it takes a lot of willpower, it takes a lot of hard work, and maybe a little, you work harder than other guys. But you know, I grew up with guys that played, you know, fantastic. Bertie Seren and Claude Jensen, my two buddies in Valmarie, were just fantastic hockey players, and we talked about going to the NHL and playing sock hockey, and we're all going to be in the NHL playing for Toronto, and over to Climax with my buddies over there, and oh, we're all going to the NHL, you know, to play at Montreal. Oh, we're going to play the NHL. And you know, just you know, I just kind of like kept sneaking through another window or another door that would open. And you know, take advantage of it. And, you know, good things happen for me. So I, yeah, no, it's, there's just a lot of great stories.
You know, yeah, but you know what, success is when preparation meets opportunities. And you've had, you know, got your opportunities, but you were definitely prepared. You know, I want to talk about that, the line you forged, the Trio Grande, Mike Bossy and Clark Gillies. You know, tell us about Mike. We lost both Mike and Clark this year. So it's been a tough year for you, I'm sure. But tell us about Mike. What did he mean to you, and how did he help to make you a better player?
Well, our Trio Grande line is just it's two of my best friends, two of the best people you ever want to play with. You know, there's just a lot of chemistry that happened. And all three of us appreciate each other. There was a dynamic, I think, that makes that kind of unity work. And, you know, Clark was the big guy. He had big man presence. And, you know, Mike was the sniper. Like, he could score just goal. He was just a natural goal scorer, underrated playmaker, stick handler, a passer. Like, he just underrated in a lot of areas. And I was just kind of like the guy that just kind of like pushed the puck around, whatever, and just, you know, cleaned up on, you know, little tap-in rebounds or whatever. But I was one of those guys, I think, that made things, I kind of did a little bit of everything, but not anything, one thing great, but I could do a lot of things that were kind of good. But Mike and Clark were special. They were special because they had something that other guys couldn't do that were just spectacular. You know, Clark was, again, underrated on playmaking, stick handling, shooting, all that stuff. But he was a presence. And there was nobody in the NHL had a presence like Clark Gillies. And he was on my line. There was nobody could score goals like Mike Bossy. And he was on my line. And we were three guys that just looked at each other and we just smiled because we knew there was something special with us. And if something wasn't working early in a game, we'd remind ourselves. We just remind ourselves right on the bench sometimes, like, hey, we got to be better, or I got to be better, or hey, do a little more of this. Let's go and rev each other up, and something good or great would happen, and it did for a long time. You know, we played together for almost 10 years, and you know, off and on through playoffs, off and on here and there, but always went back to each other, like power plays or whatever. And no, Mike and Dennis are both, I mean, Clark were just really big part of my success. And I hope I had a little bit to do with theirs. But that Trio Grande is, you know, I got to tell you a quick story. We went down to Tampa, and it was like the battle of the big lines, and we're all been retired for quite a while. And Mike hadn't skated for 3 or 4 years. And Clark Gillies was all excited. We get down there and his groin is a little sore. And I said, well, you guys, we'll have some fun. We'll play against the French Connection and, you know, the Triple Crown line. And we end up in the finals against the French Connection, Rene Robert and Rick Martin and Gilbert Perreault. And we're playing a 4-on-4 tournament. And God, it's just fire wagon hockey, end-to-end action. And Mike ends up scoring 7 of our 8 goals. We win 8-7. Mike scores a typical Mike Bossy goal, you know, C&I puck on his stick, boom, threw everybody in the back of the net, 20 seconds to go in the game, and Gilbert Perreault comes, he goes, Bryan, I think Mike Bossy come out the vagina scoring goals. And it was one of my favorite lines because it's so true. Like, Mike is just that kind of person that just has the ability to just naturally find the net, shoot it, and you learn from guys like that. I learned how to score from Mike Bossy. Like, I scored some goals in junior, and yeah, but playing with Mike, it was like special. Like, he'd say, yeah, just put the puck on the net or put the puck 5-hole. There'd be a rebound. And I'm like, I never seen anybody score with so many 5-hole goals as Mike Bossy. And sometimes I said, you know how to put it. I said, if I scored 5-hole, it's because it's the goalie's fault. You did it on purpose. but I had an accurate shot. Mike had a powerful accurate shot. Clark had a powerful, heavy, heavy booming shot. I think it was intimidation, but no, it was a fun, you know, trio to play together, and, you know, just wonderful memories. Very, very sad. Like, it's horrible. You know, my bang, bang, both of them gone. You know, the families, I'm just, we're all still, we're reeling a little bit, but we're rallying, and, but believe me, it's tough to lose two of your teammates, let alone two of your best friends that have gone too young.
Well, you know, I know you give Mike and Clark a lot of credit for your success, and rightly so. They were amazing. You know, Bossy, as you said, hadn't skated in 3 years, and he scored seven of your team's eight goals in the 3-on-3. That's pretty cool. So the battle of the great lines. No, but you were not bad yourself. I mean, you had a couple of 5-goal games. You had the game against Rangers where you had 6 points in one period, which is a record that still stands. I think maybe Sittler might have touched that one, and when he had his 10-point game, I don't know. But you know, you had a couple. I think you had eight points that night. What happens, you know, to you when you get a game like that? What's going on with you?
Well, it was one of those nights. I think you know, I had a few of those nights, which really make it fun, you know. And it happened against our rivals. I think what happens, I think the Ranger game was I think December 78 or 79, and it was a rival game, obviously, so there's a lot of hype and a lot of, you know, you rev yourself up and you're not going to lose, and every goal is a big goal, and you know, our power play was hot, puck was finding me, every time I shot it seemed to go in, but nobody says, oh, there's Bryan Trottier, that great goal scorer. And again, it's just like being sneaky, you know, like just the little Indian in me that just kind of like sneaks around, you know, pots a couple of goals here and there. Next thing you know, you have a big night, but you want to win, and you want to win. And if you're not trying to, you know, rub salt in the wound, you just want to win. You want to sting them. You want to send a message. I think another 5-goal against Philadelphia. So the rival games, you're up, you're riding it. You want to sting them. You want to like send them home and say, hey, you know what? You know, I'm not just going to beat you. I'm going to beat you. And every time I play, you know, I'm going to try to sting you. So, and you build a little bit of a reputation, and they know that it's going to be a battle. And I like those battles. I like going home exhausted, nothing in the tank kind of thing. And that's, I wanted to play a good game and contribute and find a way. And, you know, it's no different than a lot of the players. I'm not talking about Wayne or Mario or the very, very elite, the Mike Bossies that, you know, were brilliant goal scorers. I was just one of those guys that wanted to contribute in big ways, whether it was offensively or a little sting with a hit or a little something that could make our team win. I wanted to win. And I think, you know, our team kind of felt that. I think guys knew that about me, whether they were teammates or the opposition. Like, it wasn't just going to be, okay, if we keep Bryan off the scoreboard, it's like, okay, well, we're going to keep him off the scoreboard and keep your head up a little bit. And at the same time, you know, watch out because he'll set up his line mates and he'll do other things, you know, that'll just kind of help his team win. So those nights were special because, like, you're kind of getting the record books for your offensive abilities. So yeah, no, they're fun little tidbits of my career. Believe me, I take great pride in them, but they reflect well on my teammates again, because Mike and Clark and our power play, Dennis Potvin, and the team, they, you know, you don't do it by yourself. You're just kind of jumping on opportunities and, you know, maybe a goalie that's not having a great night, but you know, I think we did it as a group more so than me as an individual. I ended up having an 8-point game and a couple 5-goal games.
Well, yeah, you had playoff hat tricks, you know, and you did a lot of this stuff against, as you mentioned, your rivals, which makes it look very special. Well, there's a playoff hat. Playoff hat trick, part of that one.
Well, that was, I think, against Toronto, I believe. And
yeah, you know, Toronto, that's a playoff hat trick. That you lost that series, I believe. Yeah, but you got the hat trick in that series. Yes.
Yeah. Well, Toronto had our number in 78, and it kind of made us angry. But you know, again, it's just one of those things. You know, like there's a Mike Bossy quick shot, boom, rebound, I tap in. You know, like it. But when we kind of owed Toronto, we didn't want to lose to them, so we kind of, it was a little angry or something, I don't know, but you'll find another level when you're mad, or you know, you're out to do something, prove something to another team. But I think it was just, I think I'm playing against my old buddy Tiger in that series too, which makes it tough because I don't like playing against them. And we played against them in Vancouver in the finals too, and that was tough too, because you know, he's, you know, you love the man, but you also, you know, he's looking at you like, hey, I gotta beat you, and I know professional side takes over, the friendship is gone for that 60-minute battle, and we'd sneak out afterwards and say our lows or share a quick dinner. But No, it was, we owed Toronto. And I think Paul Mateer was outstanding. Like, you know, we couldn't find holes against that kid, but we did the next time we played them. So like, that's what anger does, I guess. I don't know.
Well, I want to talk about that because, I mean, you had a great season. I want to just touch on 78, 79, 47 goals, 87 assists, 134 points. You won the Art Ross Trophy, the Hart Trophy. Not bad for a kid from Ville-Marie that almost quit hockey when he was in Swift Current. But then so there were playoff disappointments, which you touched on against the Leafs and others. And then you finally reached the promised land, winning the Stanley Cup. What was it like to hoist Stanley for the first time? Because as you said, when you were 8 years old, you turned to your dad and you said, I'm going to lift Stanley up one someday. And that happened. What was that like?
Oh, there's no better feeling in the game of hockey. You have a dream and you're young playing the NHL, score a goal, help your team win. And then you raise the cup. That's your dream. And that moment happens and you can go over and you can hug the cup. And I did. I did all of that. I wanted to feel the names engraved on the cup, and I wanted to see how heavy it was. And I wanted to feel the feeling that Jean Béliveau had, you know, just hugging it and raising it up. And, you know, he didn't pump it up over his head like they do now. But I did it exactly like Jean Béliveau did. I held it the way Jean Béliveau held it. I didn't hold it by the ends. I held it like it was a little baby going up over my head. And the place goes crazy. I mean, Nassau Coliseum went crazy, and I went crazy, obviously, and it was just a chilling moment. But there's no greater feeling. It's just it's that special moment when a dream comes true, and you're actually living it, and your senses peak, and you want to remember it. And, you know, so your smell, your touch, your hearing, everything is just magnified. And it was a special, special moment.
What do you think was a missing piece? I mean, because you had those playoff disappointments beforehand, was there a player that came in? I know people talk about Goring and, you know, or was it just you guys maturing? What was the key factor in your mind?
Well, I think a little bit of both. I think 78 was a tough loss against the Maple Leafs. I mean, Lanny scores a goal that knocked us out, but you learn from that. You learn how this is the ladder you got to climb. And then 79 against the Rangers, our rivals, and both times, and this, I mean, this is reflection more so than at the time, but both times hot goaltenders, like you talk about, you know, Paul Mateer in 78 and Toronto, they were the team, they wanted to knock us off, and they were hungrier than us, and Rangers were hungrier than us, and John Davidson was red hot. And, you know, we weren't prepared. We weren't ready to win. We weren't ready to do the extra stuff that we had to do to overcome. And, you know, we get a little bit more chemistry. You know, Kenny Morrow, Butch Goring. There was just Dwayne Sutter comes up from junior in December, and there's another level of chemistry, a little bit of added something, you know, to the ingredients. And Billy Smith all of a sudden becomes a stone wall. He doesn't want to get beat. And I think the Islanders saw something in Smitty, because they kept flip-flopping between Chico and Smitty, and all of a sudden, you know, Smitty becomes the goalie in Boston and never left the net after that. It was just like one of those things where we all kind of rallied at the right time and believed in each other and, you know, took the next step. And there's a little bit of, you know, gaining experience, learning how to win, and then chemistry of a team, you know, and then if it's an injury happens, how to, like, you know, plug the hole till the guy gets back, kind of thing. And it's all a learning process. And even for our management, you know, I think Al and Bill were spectacular at molding a young group of guys, and we were just like, you know, dumb and naive, and, you know, just eager beavers listening to everything they tell us. And yeah, we want to win. Yeah, we want to do this. We want to do it the right way. We want to earn it. And we did. And from that, we earned, you know, three more in a row. And because we were diligent, we were the best conditioned team, we were the best confident team, we were the best this. We practiced like we were the best, and we believed confidence grew. And, you know, we almost like intimidate teams before we step on the ice, because how the heck are we going to beat these Islanders? And, it was wonderful having that swagger. Because all of a sudden, you know, when we got beat in 84, we had the same team pretty much, you know, maybe a little bit banged up, but when all of a sudden teams weren't they weren't intimidated by us anymore. And it's interesting because I look back and say, well, not at the time, but when you look back, you go, God, you know, like we used to go in St. Louis and Minnesota and we'd be like, almost have a one or two goal advantage. And, you know, they didn't even, you're not champions anymore. You're not the king of the castle. And so there's just a different kind of like pregame, you know, intensity that comes from that. So, no, it was a wonderful, wonderful time, but, you know, everything comes to an end.
Yeah, we had Randy Greig on the show a couple of weeks ago, and he talked about how they watched you guys, right? When they lost, you know, in 83, they watched you guys, and they saw what you guys did and what it took. And in the dressing room afterwards, you guys were all beat up. You did whatever you had to do to get there. And the Oilers knew that they had to take it to that next level. You know, they added some toughness in McClellan and stuff like that, too. I mean, there was a couple of changes that they made that was helpful. But I want to just show you another quick highlight. This next play, don't blink or you'll miss it. This is the opening faceoff here. You're playing the Bruins. You're through the Bruins. And boom, that goal took 5 seconds off the opening draw. 5 seconds. And one of the viewers asked me to ask you, you know, you were one of the best faceoff guys ever, you know, one of the best in the faceoff circle. How important was that to your success? Clearly it helped there.
Oh, no, without a doubt. Like, you take a lot of pride in being a faceoff guy. My rookie year, I didn't take a lot of faceoffs in my zone. Eddie Westphal took them all, and it really made me angry and a little embarrassed at times because Eddie would come out and take all the defensive zone faceoffs. And I'd ask Al, you know, obviously with respect, I'd say, Al, like, I don't, you know, he goes, you'll be taking a lot of faceoffs for your time. Learn, watch everybody. And I studied everybody. And I did. I practiced and practiced and practiced. I was good on faceoffs, but you want to become not just okay and good. You want to be the best. You want to become what I used to think was just unpredictable. So I'd go some forehand, some backhand, some this way, some, and set people up. And there's faceoffs that aren't important, like neutral zone faceoffs are not that important, so to speak. But there's also the most important faceoffs, which are all the offensive zone faceoffs, defensive zone faceoff, power play faceoffs, penalty kill faceoff. And you really pride yourself in those moments. And that's what I did. I just studied and minded myself and became very, very diligent on how to balance and you know, technique, you know, watch the referee's hands, just a lot of things that that helped me become really good at faceoffs. Then stay unpredictable. You know, there's times like Steve Casper on that draw wants to win every draw, and I'm looked at my, I think it's Mike and Greg Gilbert was playing left wing that night, and I just looked at him. I said, we're forechecking their defense, like he wants to win. I'm going forward with this draw, and we're going to pressure their D right off the faceoff here. So that's a faceoff where we go on the offense, we pressure, we're forechecking on a faceoff versus trying to win the draw, countering and coming back and attacking. We're attacking right off a faceoff with a forecheck. And even though you don't win the draw, you do. And there's lots of faceoffs I didn't win, but I didn't lose. You lose them kind of on purpose, so to speak. And, you know, your faceoffs at the end of the night might be 50-50, but, you know, you've won all the biggest draws, the most important draws of the night. It's kind of how I looked at it. Doesn't mean I'm right, but it worked for me. It works for a lot of other guys because Butch Goring and I talked about it a lot of times because we flip-flopped on a lot of face-offs, come here to Pittsburgh and, you know, flip-flop with Ron Francis and myself on a lot of face-offs. And there's times we say, we might not win this one, but we're not going to lose it. And you put it to an area where, you know, it becomes not dangerous. So, yeah, there's a lot of different thought processes and techniques, I think, and decisions that get made on a face-off draw. You talk to your wingers, defensemen, you say, okay, I'm going to go push it here. And a lot of times I talk to Billy Smith and Tommy Barrasso, just say, hey, guys, the puck might be coming right back at you, so be ready. And they just kind of nod. When the draw right at them, they'd be, boom, they just set it up for the defensemen, or the way we break out. And,
right.
You know, it becomes a confidence thing on everybody's part, but mindful at the same time. You're reminding everybody every face-off. So I'd remind everybody, okay, here's where it's going, here's where it's not going. And you just become very, very mindful. But that was unique because it just, Mike O'Connell stepped up. I chopped it by him, and Milbury had the angle on me there. And I just kind of took three more steps and hit a rolling puck that kind of knuckleballed on Mike Keane's and caught the far left corner. But it was, You know, and that's what you do, kind of catch somebody off guard, catch them all off guard. Everybody's not, you know, like, okay, it's the start of a game. Oh, yeah, well, it might, you know, something fun might happen. And, you know, and I look back at that and I said to myself, like, oh, you share a record with Doug Schmale and McGillney. I think, I don't know if there's anybody else, but 5 seconds. And I think Patrick Kane or somebody. And I said, you know what? If you look and you do, you have a stopwatch, I think I'm 4.4. And those other guys are like 4.7, 4.8. I think I beat them all by a little bit. They just didn't have those seconds.
I like to tease the guys. That was tough to beat, no doubt about it. And making your goaltender aware would be really a good idea, because you hate like hell to score on your own goaltender when you're that good.
I scored one on a faceoff. I top shelf on Chico. I pulled it back and I told Chico, be ready. Puck might be coming back. And he was there, and I pulled it back in my backhand. I couldn't have got it any better. I got good wood on it, and it went right over his shoulder.
Thanks, Trotz.
Oh, my fault. I was ready, and I wasn't that ready.
Oh, wonderful. Hell, we got something else for you that's pretty wonderful. Paul Patsku, our librarian, just dug up some really cool stuff. So this is you and Ron Duguay. And you're at center ice, and you're playing a little tune. Listen to that, Vic. Yeah. So tell me what was
going on. Yeah, Ron got the place going. Ron got, look at that dance. He's got him rocking. I like it. I'm just the guitar guy. He's the dancer. Listen, he's got him going.
So your Johnny Cash voice is great, and your guitar playing is great too. What precipitated this?
Well, you know what? It was Steve Shutt. We were doing we're doing the Old Timers tour, and Gilbert Perreault, myself, we were after one of the games, there was a band playing. So I went up and sang a couple tunes and got Gilbert to sing a little bit. And Steve said, we got to do this on the ice somehow. So we brought Johnny Cash. We brought Michael Burgess, who's one of Canada's famous singers, obviously. And I got to do some songs with him. And then we did a couple songs with some other people that were just, you know, big star. I'm just an okay singer. Like, we had a family band growing up, and I was the bass player, and Dad taught me how to play bass guitar and taught myself how to play strum a guitar. And I'm not a great musician per se, but I can strum a guitar, and if I got some singers, we can have pretty good hootenanny. But we had an opportunity to bring a different flavor to the old timers game. So I'd sneak out there 5 minutes to go and do a Johnny Cash song or a Willie Nelson song. And so it was really kind of a different side of the hockey players that people could see, and a different dynamic to a game that was about hockey and bring music aspect to it. And so Steve Shutt was really his idea, to where all of a sudden it you know, morphed into me and Ron Duguay center ice, and, you know, he's shaking the crowd and I'm just kind of strumming the Johnny Cash song. So it was a lot of fun, wonderful memories.
Yeah, it looked like a lot of fun. Now, I want to talk to you something about, you had a couple more cups in Pittsburgh. When the Penguins won the cup, they had gone, like the Islanders before, gone a couple of major playoff disappointments. But you get there and boom, two straight cups. What got that team to the top?
Well, again, I think, kudos to Craig Patrick. When I talked to Craig, you know, he asked me why I wanted to come to Pittsburgh. And I said, I want to come to win a cup with Mario Lemieux. And he was really, you know, I shortened the story, but he said, I'll have a contract to you in 15 minutes. And I think when you come with a commitment, I think you come with an idea that it's a 1-year contract and you're fully all in. I think Craig realized that, and he found guys, Joe Mullen and, you know, veteran guys that were as committed. And then, you know, he made some trades with Ronnie Francis, Ulf Samuelson, you know, got Pete Taglinetti and Larry Murphy. There was just a whole bunch of things I think that Craig should get a lot of credit for, bringing in a dynamic group, Gordy Roberts, all guys that were really committed. You know, Mario was not 100%, but Mario is as good, you know, at 50% as anybody else in the league at 100%. And he came and he, you know, he's a magician. He's a magnificent player, obviously, but he had big man presence, much like Clark Gillies. And, you know, when he got on the ice, he did his magic and made a young Jaromir Jagr. We just had a whole group of guys that were spectacular. And all of a sudden we get that taste of playoff hockey, and they hadn't had it for a while. And, you know, Eager Beegers, Paul Coffey was in Pittsburgh when I got here. And, you know, we talk about the Oilers, Islander dynasties and those kind of thing. And people want to hear those stories, and they want to be a part of it. And they go, okay, what do we expect this round? What do we expect this game? And, you know, we had good leadership in that room. And I think Craig did a magnificent job. And Bob Johnson, the first year, Scotty Bowman did a dynamic, you know, had their dynamic moments behind the bench where, you know, they're putting guys together at the right time. And so, yeah, there's a lot of unique things happen. And then the foot soldiers like Phil Bork, Bob Erie, you know, Troy Loney, guys that had been here for a while that were hungry. And, you know, I think Pittsburgh in general, the city rallied. I think they were hungry for a champion. They're city of champions. And finally, hockey's on the map and Mario and the whole group just kind of, I don't know, merged and confluenced at the right time. And, you know, we rode that wave and we rode it right into like a, you know, back-to-back Stanley Cups. And so it's really kind of fun when, you know, you sign a contract, a one-year contract, you come with the idea, you know, I'm coming to win a cup with Mario, and it happens. And so then we did it again. Craig said, do you want to do it again? I said, yeah, same, let's do it again. And we did it back-to-back. For me, it was vindication a little bit because I kind of left the island, not in great terms, but, you know, I didn't feel appreciated. And I come to Pittsburgh, I'm appreciated all over again. So you win back-to-back championships. I'm feeling really good about myself, you know. So opportunity turned into an opportunity in Pittsburgh turned into an opportunity to coach. So I jumped into the coaching position for a while, assistant coaching, player coach, and then later tried to push the head coaching thing, but I just don't have that demeanor to be head coach. And you find out early, because like the Ranger job taught me, like I said, you know what, I can be a really good assistant coach. I just don't want to be a head coach. I don't want to be the guy that has to answer to the press every time and give away all your secrets and not give away all your secrets. You know, but I said, I can help our team. And, you know, do you end up coaching with Ted Nolan in Buffalo for a year? And that was a lot of fun to learn Buffalo and work with Ted Nolan was special. And then now we're doing three ice. We're doing a three-on-three league this summer. So that's going to be another opportunity to coach, you know, high-skilled players in a really fast environment where they can, you know, show off their skills and creativity and end-to-end action. The goaltenders are going to sleep well, but a lot of offense involved. So we're pretty excited about the three ice this summer. Starts June 20th and ends end of August. So it's got its only unique spot here. And, you know, Ryan Malone's going to be involved. He's probably our biggest NHL name. And but there's lots of creative young players that are going to be there, and I'm excited about that. So, you know, yeah, opportunity in Pittsburgh was spectacular. I mean, it was a wonderful 2 years of playing, 3 years of playing. I think I played another year after that, then went into coaching. And so I think it looked really good on Craig. It looked good on a lot of us players because we carry a bond that is special. You know, you win with players and you walk together for the rest of your life. I've heard that phrase a couple of different times. Freddie Shero and Bob Johnson told it to us and Minnesota, and it's so true. Like, it's just a great bond, and bond with the city, bond with Penguin fans, and I still live here in Pittsburgh, so it's been a wonderful, wonderful run.
Well, I understand you got a pretty nice bonus for those two Stanley Cups in Pittsburgh as well, part of the deal that you worked out.
Negotiation 101.
No, we just saw some of the video of the three ice tryouts. So there's six teams, two Canadian clubs. Kind of sounds like the original six here, Bryan. You got Team Carboneau, Team Fuhr, Team LeClaire, Team Mullen, Team Murphy, and Team Trottier. So what? Anybody on Team Trottier that sort of sticks out for you, sort of a hidden gem that you've sort of come across?
Well, we'll get probably my first rounder was a kid named Cam Connor. He's a wonderful high-skilled player. You know, he's not the biggest man, but boy, is he talented. Great hands, can finish, speed. Got another young kid named Sean Doogie, who's out Arizona area, and he's just all speed. He's not very big, 5'6" or something. And that's a lot of the league, is they're not big guys, but they're really fast and very, very good hands, very good finish. So yeah, my team is speed. We got a lot of creativity, and we got this wonderful thing called spirit. So that's what I drafted. And if Grant Fuhr hadn't drafted Ryan Malone, Ryan's 40 years old. He played high school hockey with my son, and he's still in great shape. He's got great hands. He came to Mario Lemieux's camp and impressed Grant Fuhr and I, who were co-coaches together here, and we end up being, you know, coaches in the three ice, and we both looked at each other and we're like, these guys don't know Ryan Malone like we know Ryan Malone. But you know, I think the whole league, like Larry Murphy's teams, Guy Carboneau's team, Joe Mullen's team, Joe drafted his own son, Patrick Mullen, who had a wonderful camp. And it's really nice to see that the league as a whole is going to promote high skill. Craig Patrick's our commissioner. It's going to promote a lot of action, a lot of the overtime stuff that you see in the NHL, which is, you know, just that high intensity, back and forth hockey, and a lot of ice to work with. So it's, I mean, these are short periods, 8-minute periods, and it's over in a snap. And players are off the ice, they're on the ice, they're getting a quick blow, they're going right back. So they only have four forwards and two defensemen. So six forwards and one goaltender. So you're on the ice for maybe 30, 45 seconds, boom, you're off the ice resting for the next 30, 45 seconds. So it's, you gotta be in shape. So it takes a lot of, team moxie, because the players, you're working with each other for each other. So I told my team, I said, we've got, everybody's a leader in this room. Nobody's a follower. Nobody's going to wait for the next guy. You got to be a leader. So if you got something to say it out loud so we all hear it. And the guys are fantastic. These guys are they're hungry. There's prize money. There's bonus money. So yeah, it'll be fun for the fans. It'll be fun for the coaches, and extremely fun for the players, I'm sure.
How good a line would Mike Bossy, Bryan Trottier, Dennis Potvin look in 3-on-3 hockey in your prime?
We would dominate. No, but that's how you got to think. You know, we're going to have some fun. We're going to have opportunities. We'll kind of keep their opportunity. But the thing is like, you're giving up an opportunity, maybe. Yeah, if you can block a shot or, intercept a pass or whatever, that's one thing. But you're going to give up opportunities. But you got to get more opportunities and take advantage of your opportunities more so than the other team. That's really kind of it in a nutshell.
Any team that's I just wanted to digress here just one little bit. Any team that's impressed you the most in the NHL playoff tournament this year so far?
Yeah, well, I'm very impressed with the Colorado team. Like I thought that was going to be a long series. I thought that was going to be that Colorado team is really impressing me. You know, I don't see enough of them during the regular season, but through the playoffs, they've got a lot of depth. Speed. They play well as a unit. Their goaltending seems to come up with the big save at the right time. The Rangers, I think, have done a magnificent job of impressing me too. Like, they're finding ways to continue to shine here and getting down to the final four. So I think Tampa's got their hands full. Tampa's always impressing me. They're a team. They're the champion. They got the swagger, the confidence. So no, it's been a wonderful playoff to watch for the hockey fans.
Now, okay, back to the three ice. For when does the season start, and how can we see some three ice hockey?
Well, we start June 20th in Vegas. It's going to be streamed. I think there's going to be some of it's going to be televised. We move around. It's kind of a carnival kind of an atmosphere. We play in, I think, 8 different cities. We'll be in Vegas twice. We start and finish in Vegas. We move around. We're going to be in Pittsburgh. We'll be in Nashville. We've got, I think, one game in Canada is in London. So opportunity to see us at 3ice.com. The schedule is all right there. You know, if it's near you, come see us. If not, try to find us online and stream us, because it's going to be pretty entertaining hockey. And We think that, you know, the whole package from start to finish starts, and all the games will be played in 2.5 hours. So it's like bang, 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 round robin, playoffs, and then the championship game, and then off to the next city the next weekend. So it's a Friday. We come in Friday, games are on Saturday afternoon, and we go home either Saturday night or Sunday morning. So it's players bring their own skates, their own equipment each week. So it's not the NHL in that regard where you're, but it's also an opportunity for these players to make a couple extra bucks, show their skills, and who knows? I think if they promote themselves and shine, they might get an opportunity to lengthen their careers and move up a league or two. Who knows? I think it's the players are really pretty excited about it, and they're all great athletes. They're working hard. They came in great shape, and so yeah, it should be a really entertaining brand of hockey for our hockey fans.
Yeah, you know what? Who doesn't like 3-on-3 hockey? It's so much fun. It just really is. And I'm helping the guys with the 3HL tour up here. It's hopefully we can get this thing going and have some fun with it. Anyway, Bryan, I want to thank you for taking the time to join us. I know you got to scoot and go look at some 3A stuff. Thanks for being here, buddy. It's been a pleasure.
Thanks, Joe. Pleasure visit with you. Thank you. Got a lot of good stuff there today. Talked about a lot of fun stuff, but thank you for letting me talk about All Roads Home and our 3 Eyes projects and some wonderful memories with the Islanders and Penguins and, you know, just hockey in general, my good buddies. And I miss them. I miss Clark and Mike, and we'll all miss them, but it's been a fun little visit with you here this morning. Thank you. Continue to success. Thanks, pal. Talk to you later.
Thanks, Bryan. Good luck with All Roads Home coming up in October, and we'll have more sports when we come back.
More Joe Tilley's Great Canadian Sports Show coming up after the break.
Sports Canada!
Guests on Joe Tilley Sports receive a gift certificate from Classica Imports. Top of the line imported men's clothing. Check out the Classica Essential Collection now. Go to shopclassica.com.
Hey, this is Tommy Graisley, a.k.a. Tommy Gunn. I love two things, music and sports. And when I want sports, I go to the Joe Tilley Show. He gives me everything I want. It's a great show. Check it out for yourself. Joe Tilley Sports, coming up.
Good night.
Addiction Rehab Toronto, Toronto's number one alcohol and drug treatment center, saving lives, reuniting families. The only treatment center in the province to offer medical detox, treatment, sober living, and lifetime aftercare all in one place. Our unique and specialized programs are designed to equip our clients with the tools to successfully lead a life of dignity, respect, and purpose. Let us help save your life or your loved one's life. Call today for more information or to facilitate an intervention. 1-855-787-2424 or visit addictionrehabtoronto.ca. Joe Tilley Sports is brought to you by COSA, Central Ontario Standardbred Association, providing a united voice for harness horse people racing at Ontario tracks. Check out your benefits today at COSAonline.com and check out COSA TV on Facebook and YouTube for all the latest harness news and live action updates. Live racing year-round. Go to HPIBet.com for all your wagering options. Become a member today and your first bet is free. That's HPIBet.com.
Do you know why that happened? You didn't fix your ball mark. The birds around here are very protective of the course, and when people don't take care of it, this is what happens. It's pretty simple. Just find your mark, fix it, and at least one other. Hey, look at the bright side. We're not up on the northern course. They've got bears and moose.
Visit moregolf.ca today. You'll find everything a golfer could need, from balls, gloves, and clubs to custom fitting opportunities and training gear. Go to moregolf.ca and get $20 off your first purchase of $100 or more. Just enter the promo code JT Sports.
Yes, my Cosa Swiss pick of the week. Last week, I went to Mohawk for Thursday night's fifth race, the first leg of the grassroots series for three-year-old filly trotters. I took the number four horse, Angelonia, who was neck and neck with the leader heading into the final turn, but she couldn't close the deal. Stormont Mabel with Jean-Philippe Roy driving, held on for the win for trainer Desiree Jones. The 2-4 exactor was a good one for $50. This week, I'm going to Saturday night's eliminations for the Pepsi North America Cup, Canada's richest harness race. Not sure of the draw yet, but I'm sure of my pick. Whatever eliminator he draws into, Pebble Beach will get it done. For all the racing updates, visit Cosa TV on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. Go to hpibet.com for your wagering options.
This is the Excellent Sports Adventure, brought to you by Lycom.
Well, they finally saw that winning streak come to an end. But, hey, the Blue Jays did get back on the rails for one game anyway. That's what can happen when you put the ball in the very capable right hand of Jose Berrios. Berrios, with a career-high 13 strikeouts over seven innings against the Twins, bouncing back nicely from a rough start in Anaheim. Alejandro Kirk, who was just scorching hot, pounded out his fourth home run of the year. The Jays' young catcher is something else, isn't he? Vlad Guerrero Jr. provided some pop as well. Muscles an inside pitch right out of the ball yard. Two-run shot. Vlad's 12th big bop of the season. That is some power and pitching.
He dominated with all his pitches, you know, and he made it one mistake, 2-0 to a good hitter, Polanco. It took him deep, and then he made an adjustment, threw strikes with all his pitches. I'll tell you what, that his slider was huge today. I don't know if you guys could see it on TV, but it was like a frisbee today. So that he got the lefties out for sure with that pitch. You know, then we get a chance to win every day. And you know, the one thing about Berrios, we're actually 8-3 when he starts. You know, of course, he hasn't been the Berrios we expected, but today it was awesome to see him come back from that start in Anaheim and pitch like that today. That was huge.
Like a frisbee. Pretty awesome. The CFL's regular season opens this weekend. The Argos and Ticats closed out the preseason against each other. Chad Kelly hits Isaiah Wright for a touchdown. Boris Beedy kicked his fourth field goal of the game with no time left to lift the boatmen to an 18-17 victory. The Argos get a bye this week while the Cats are in Regina to open the season. Hamilton's Spencer Wilcox improved to 3-0 as a pro at Casino Montreal this past week. The talented lightweight scored a four-round decision over a tough Mexican fighter named Juan Carlos Ramirez Garcia. Now it's on to some six-rounders.
Even though everyone wants a knockout, I think it was a better experience doing the four rounds with an opponent like that than getting somebody I could finish the first round or two. It was a good fight. We knew he was 4-1. We knew he was going to be tough, but I'm happy with the performance. Like I said, better experience doing that than finishing them in the first round. There will be a lot to take away from. Right now my adrenaline is pretty high, so I can't think too much about the fight, but when we rewatch it, I'm sure there will be a million mistakes we can fix. That's just part of the sport. Right now I think we're going to get a month off and probably aim for something in the end of the summer. But hopefully in between then we can do some training camps internationally and get some more experience.
Today's environmental tip: avoid using bottled water. Yes, the process of manufacturing water bottles contributes to water shortages. It takes more water to produce a plastic water bottle than there is water inside the bottle. Transporting bottled water creates more greenhouse gases. It takes over 1,000 years for plastic water bottles to decompose, and the process leaks harmful chemicals into the soil.
RICOM, passionate people who turn complicated business problems into simplified technology solutions for public and private sector real estate, properties, portfolios, and enterprise customers. Optimize and future-proof smart buildings from the ground up. The latest in fault locating, base building network design, managed services, cybersecurity, data analytics. Our fault detection will support all smart strategies, define projected outcomes for capital planning, and reduce environmental impact. RICOM, smart protection solutions. At RICOM, we're building a path to a smart and environmentally friendly future.
There will be 21 Canadians teeing it up in this week's RBC Canadian Open. Mike Weir will be playing his 29th Canadian Open. Watch for Corey Connors, Mackenzie Hughes, Adam Hadwin, Nick Taylor, Adam Svensson, Michael Glidzik, and Taylor Pendrith. Now it's time for our one-shot shootout shot of the week.
God damn it.
Four! Our shot of the week is brought to you by one-shot shootout. It only takes one shot. There's Ken Shaw, the anchor man. He is definitely anchoring this team. And right there, he sticks it tight. That is tight. Kenny, a reasonable chance for birdie.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
And we want to thank all the folks who make this show possible. These are friends, trusted business associates, and all-around great folks. We highly recommend them all. A reminder that the show is available on iTunes, Spotify, Breaker, Radio Public, Google Podcast, and Pocket Cast, as well as the Spanglish Network, Zingo TV, and Buzz TV Live. Also, please like and subscribe to the show on YouTube. It's free. All of our past shows and great segments are on there. Check them out. Once again, thanks to Bryan Trottier for being on the show. Thank you for watching, and join us next week when Mark Curtin drops by. We'll see you then.
Joe Tilley's Great Canadian Sports Show is brought to you by Brian Gribben Insurance Planning, helping you solidify your financial future.
At BGIP, what we do that's unique in the marketplace is we show people how to spend and enjoy their money in the early years of retirement without fear of running out. Also, we're able to do this without you having to change financial advisors. Please look us up at bgip.ca today. Let's book a 30-minute phone call to see how we can bring value to you and your family and your planning.
Call Brian today for all your retirement needs. We did. 905-686-5678.
Do you want to buy or sell a home? Could 31 years of real estate experience help you? Why not speak to an amazing team that loves to overpromise and overdeliver? Aldo has a tremendous team of experts on staff. They are committed to making your next real estate transaction smooth and comfortable. Call 416-GET-ALDO or visit getaldo.com.
MNP, a leading Canadian national accounting, tax, and business accounting firm. MNP proudly serves and responds to the need of their clients in the private, public, and nonprofit sectors. Through partner-led engagements, MNP provides a collaborative, cost-effective approach to do business and personal strategies to help people and organizations to succeed across the country and around the world. With local offices in Oshawa, Mississauga, Burlington, and more, their team is here to support you. Visit MNP.ca today to learn more.
Hi, I'm Joe Tilley. This November, join me and my wife, Penny Claire, for a trip of a lifetime. 2 weeks in Egypt and Jordan. Imagine yourself riding a camel beside the Great Pyramids, cruising the Nile River, viewing the temples at Abu Simbel, exploring the desert at Wadi Rum, visiting the ancient city of Petra, and swimming in the world-renowned Dead Sea. Only $41.99 all-inclusive with direct flight from Toronto, free upgrade to five-star hotels, and the cruise. Visit tripoppo.com and book today to get an extra $100 room bonus credit. Let's travel.
The UPS store in Brooklyn wants to help your small business thrive. We offer shipping and more, like our pack and ship guarantee. Plus, we offer graphic design services, fast digital printing, secure document shredding, and mailboxes with a real address. Visit 31 Baldwin Street in Brooklyn, Ontario. Say you saw this on Joe Tilley's Great Canadian Sports Show, and we'll tell you how to save 10% every day.